vente. Liam Gallagher fonde Oasis à Manchester en 1992. Un an plus tard, son frère Noel le rejoint. Il prend le contrôle total de l'écriture des chansons. En 1994, Oasis joue sur scène en Écosse et signe un contrat avec un label indépendant à la sortie du concert. Le succès est fulgurant et salvateur quand on sait que l'avenir des jeunes de Manchester n'est pas toujours rose.
If anyone's ever been to Manchester, which most people probably haven't, it's an industrial city that's had the heart ripped out of it by the government, so there's a lot of factories that are empty and derelict. And there's nothing to do there. So it's a case of, if you want to, Manchester's quite a rough city. We've got gang problems and guns and drugs and all the rest of it. So if you want to get out of that lifestyle and lead a semi-normal kind of life and have money and do the things that you want to do, you've either got to be three things. One of them is a footballer or a soccer player. The other one is a drug dealer. And the other one is a musician.
Fan à mort des Beatles, Noel et Liam ont plus l'attitude bad boys des Rolling Stones. Ils refusent de se faire interviewer ensemble, trop de disputes, et chacun a quitté le groupe à deux reprises pour la même raison. Ils ne sont pas plus tendres avec les autres musiciens de groupe. Quand leur guitariste, membre fondateur, quitte Oasis cet été, le seul commentaire de Noel fut « Ce n'est pas comme si Paul McCartney quittait les Beatles ». Malgré leurs différences, Liam n'a pas de problème pour chanter les chansons de son frère.
I mean, he's thinking the same thing, and we both lived the same lives. Okay. So obviously we're both from the same, you know what I mean? If something happens, you know, we're both walking down that same road, aren't we? So yeah. Obviously we're thinking the same. I think if I have, you know, everything he writes and that, I can relate to.
Oasis au bout du micro, c'est tout de suite sur M6 Music, et juste après, un concert qui les ramène chez eux à Manchester.
Sort of generally happy-go-lucky geezers, man, who are thankful for what we've got. The important thing, I think, for us, when we started, was we always set out to be the best band in the world, and we always said that we were quite big-headed when we were a little band, and we always said we were going to be big and massive, and it's a justification for us just to make records that people are into, and for me as a songwriter, it's a justification that people think now that I'm a good songwriter, and think that we're a good band, you know, and. And that's just studio-wise, it's a justification for when we do shows that, you know, we get awarded for being the best live band in England, and that's not just down to the group, that's down to the people who work for us and people who work behind the scenes and stuff like that. So it's a justification for everyone, really, and the money helps.
A lot of different people have different reasons for starting up a band. Was there anything about your initial background growing up in England, or what was about starting up a band that seemed so appealing?
Well, if anyone's ever been to Manchester, which most people probably haven't, it's an industrial city that's This had the heart ripped out of it by the government, so there's a lot of factories that are empty and derelict. And there's nothing to do there. So it's a case of, if you want to... Manchester's quite a rough city. We've got gang problems and guns and drugs and all the rest of it. So if you want to get out of that... Get out of that lifestyle and lead a semi-normal kind of life and have money and do the things that you want to do, you've either got to be three things. One of them is a footballer or a soccer player. The other one is a drug dealer. And the other one is a musician. So we chose the third one because we're not that good at football and we don't know how to buy drugs off. So we decided to form a band, really. It's as simple as that.
What do you think you'd be doing if the band maybe wasn't there?
Probably be working for... I'd probably be doing what I was doing before.
Guitar tech?
Yeah. Probably be doing that, yeah. Lazy guitar tech, something like that. I am too tired to listen to
anything you say when I see you tomorrow. What did you learn from Spiral Carpets? I know you didn't care much for them as a band, but was there any insight into the business at all?
When I used to run their office for them and stuff like that. I suppose there was a little, but I mean... So I don't tend to dwell too much on the business side of things. Business is boring, really, isn't it? You've got managers to do all that for you, so... I don't need to get involved in any of that shit. I mean, I do... Oh, yeah.
Did you take anything from that experience and bring it to Oasis at all? No?
Now, the only thing I learned was how to cope with touring, because I've been touring for such a long time with the band, so...
People think that it's new for you, but it didn't really happen overnight for you, did it? Right? It was a long process.
Been
at it for
3 years, just sort of like doing our gigs when we wanted to do them, you know what I mean? Just working on the sound and the boardwalk, really. Not doing a lot of gigs, and then we just done one, and it happened. Alan McGee was there.
Yeah. Was that true, though? He just sort of saw you, jumped up on stage,
yeah,
and went, yeah, sign this?
We didn't jump up on stage. It was like seven people who weren't meant to be playing. And then after we'd come off, we only done four songs. He just said, you want a deal? And went, oh, I was right. You fancy a six? All of five, all of four, one of the six, mate, and that was it.
Was that maybe what sort of got the band the first deal? Was that confidence? You didn't need a manager, there was no tape involved.
Yeah, it's just,
it was confidence, wasn't it?
Just confidence and music. See, there's no point about it. You've got to have music and all. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We sounded good and we had, you know... And everyone says, yeah, it was a bit of luck. I don't believe in luck, it's a lot of bollocks.
Noel said that even.
What?
Looking back, it was a lot of it had to do with luck.
I don't believe that. You're wrong. You're wrong.
And he could say it was pure luck, really, so...
See, Liam, you know what Liam said about that? He's heard that, and there's no luck involved, he said.
Really?
He says.
And what would he know? I don't believe it's luck. What's luck? Mm. If you're f***ing good, you're good, you know what I mean? If you're shit, you're shit. You know what I mean? Like, even bands who are really f***ing shit get f***ing somewhere. Then that's fucking luck. You know what I mean? Well, we got to where we went to get.
Why do you think that Definitely Maybe is the fastest selling indie release in UK history?
Because it's good. Basically, it's just as simple as that. Plus the fact that there's nothing else about it anyway. A lot of the bands who release records in England at the moment don't really say anything to anyone. I'm not even sure what it is that we say to people, but it must be something.
It ended up becoming one of the best in Britain.
I mean, one of the best.
You
name
the
other
one. The best.
It was the other one.
Oh, well, did we get this straight at the beginning? You are the best.
Absolutely.
I wouldn't say we were handed it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we worked for it, you know what I mean? And worked hard.
Yeah.
We didn't just sort of appear overnight as Oasis number one selling band. So we weren't handed it. No, we worked for it. But I think we deserve what we've got.
Well, when you start a group and you're dreaming of all the things that are going to come your way, mm-hmm. which was the sentiment for the song Rock and Roll Star, mm-hmm. and then which ran through the whole of the album. When you actually get to being where we are today, it involves a lot of hard work. So it's just a bit, you know, I mean, I'm not moaning about it or anything like that. I mean, it's the best job in the world, but it's not as glamorous and as easygoing as people think it is. But I mean, it's better than working in a car wash, you know, so I mean, I'm not knocking it, you know.
And the winner of this award is Oasis.
Oasis, Wonderwall. Oasis.
It's a hat trick of Brits, of course, for Oasis. Best video, best album, and now best British group.
Is it anyone there?
In the best producers, right.
I'd like to thank all the fans, all the people who make us what we are. I'd like to thank all the people.
Same as we always were, you know, we're just the same four people, or same five people really, who started the group, and you know, we've never changed the way we live or anything, just because we've become a lot more famous and a lot more successful. We just do what we do.
The MTV Awards performance, this has something to do, I think, with what Alan had said about you and your sort of perception in North America, maybe specifically the US, not particularly Canada, and your perception in England, as he said, Americans don't get Liam.
You said that?
I think Alan McGee did.
Mm. I don't think many people get me. I think they get me, but I don't know. I don't get myself.
Liam doesn't even get Liam. Nobody gets Liam. Not even his wife gets Liam. Who would want him anyway?
Do you have a different persona between the two countries, do you figure?
No. In England, they know... Hey, listen, in England, they don't even get me, so fuck it. You know what I mean? And the day they do get me, the day I'll start worrying. Because I'm not doing my job proper.
American people don't like him because he's a bit confrontational. I mean, there's nothing to get me. You know, a singer sings songs. That's all there is to get about. I mean, it's like I play guitar and write songs. There's nothing else to get about me. I'm quite boring other than that.
Really?
It can be quite difficult. It must be boring to be difficult all the time. It must be boring to be that confrontational all the time, but again, you know, never mind.
When you say confrontational, he wouldn't pick a fight with people.
I'm talking about the same person here, aren't we? Of course he does. You pick a fight with his own toenails. Yeah, well, he's always claiming to be picking fights with people, but he's a pussycat, really.
Bad
battles with you and Liam, how much of that is manufactured?
About, I don't know, maybe it's 50% train, 50% manufactured, really. We disagree on a lot of things, but then again, a lot of people in the band disagree. It's not just me and him, you know, it's everyone, you know what I mean? But people just tend to make a big deal about it anyway, because it's us, you know. So I don't really take it that seriously, to be quite honest with you.
You've got a brother, you have thighs, fucks. You've got another brother, hey, you human.
We could put on an act and pretend to be like best mates and all that, but we don't. So what needs to be said, then you say it. I mean, it's boring, but that's why I don't do interviews no more. I can't bother with it anymore. It's boring. It's never boring to talk about music. It's boring to talk about everything else other than music. Or anything else that doesn't concern music.
There's been numerous articles about it, but they all concentrate on how you got signed, the fighting that you've got, smashing up hotel rooms, all this kind of carry on. Why isn't it they talk so much about the music? Because the music itself is pretty good.
That just sums up the British press, doesn't it? They haven't got much, they haven't got anything constructive to write about, you know what I mean?
So if anyone,
like a band like us, who's in the limelight, if they do anything that's out of the ordinary, then they jump on it.
Oasis is so big now that no matter what happens, you make the news. So do you feel like you're living under a microscope where every little move you make is newsworthy?
Yeah, I don't know if it's newsworthy, but it's definitely I mean, everything, we sort of tend to live our lives out in the press. It's not, I mean, it's not something that we do on purpose. It's just that, I suppose people are just interested in what we do. People just tend to sensationalise things just because it sounds good. Life in this group can be pretty boring, all the hanging around and all the rest of it, but people would have you believe that we're like smashing things up 24 hours a day, which is not true, you know?
Does it worry you, maybe there might come a day where people won't write about Oasis as much or talk about Oasis?
I hope so, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. Looking forward to that. So it's when we get a bit of peace and quiet, you know. But as long as you're writing good music and selling records, I suppose, it just comes with the job, you know what I mean? You're just going to have to live with it, so we're quite prepared to live with that.
Do you read your own press?
Oh, yeah.
Just because...
I just like reading it so I can just go, right, I'll sue you, and I'll sue you, and then I'll sue you, and then I'll sue you. That's the reason why I read it, you see. Just go, oh, what they said today, thank you very much, I have a couple of £1,000 of you. A couple of thousand pounds of you.
Especially during the record, every day there was a new Oasis story out there.
Yeah, I know. Ridiculous, isn't it? You think they can get sick of us and go and get a bloody smell.
Is it worry maybe one day the press won't be there, won't be writing about Oasis as much, though?
I suppose so, yeah. Something else will pop on. I don't know, as long as I'm talking about it, they'll be writing about me, because I'm mad for it. As long as you're doing something and they've got... I don't mind them writing about a band, they'll be doing something. But writing about what I had for dinner last night, it's not f***ing... Who gives a f***ing shit?
Okay. True Oasis fan wouldn't care.
Exactly. Who wants to know about what I had for dinner? Who gives a f***ing shit whether you're an Oasis fan or not, you know what I mean? No one's interested. You can write about an album.
Yeah.
And do what you f***ing want.
It was Mel C that issued that challenge to you at the Brit Awards. What was all that about?
I don't know. I think the lovely girls are great, really talented, and I wish them all the best in the world.
But in reality,
that's the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was that challenge? What was that challenge about?
I don't know. I don't want to get into it because what's that getting into? Scrap with them lot.
So you saw it when it was happening.
What?
So you saw it when it was happening.
So what?
That little challenge.
I don't know where it come from. Saying I was going to slap him. I don't hit girls. Someone just said it and made it up as usual. And then someone went and told the press and or whatever and all that, and that was it. I don't know what they're on about.
And Blur, Art Heart, complete pile of shit.
Girls will be boys, will be
girls. I like that song. But you know, Oasis rock. I mean, they know how to rock. They have some swagger, they have some attitude.
Oasis come along with this total f you attitude and swagger, and we're the best band on the planet, and you're not. And so how can you not?
I mean, you might be offended by it, but how can you not admire somebody who comes along and says that?
But the British media particularly has had a field day with the so-called rivalry between yourselves and Blur. Do you guys play into that? You try and ignore it?
I ignore it. Band ignore it. Don't play up to it, you know what I mean? Ignore it. It's just a media thing, like you say.
We've been guilty of rising to the bait, so to speak. Yeah. They don't like Oasis, for a start, because we don't play the game.
Well, what do you think that game is?
That game is... See, the enemy in particular seemed to think that it was them that made this band's career, which is a joke, do you know what I mean? It's an absolute joke. We were in the top 40 before they put us on the f***ing cover, you know what I mean? So, how they came about this, it's because every other band's be-all and end-all of their career has been on the front of a music magazine. And it's like, if that is what it's about, then I'd rather not be in a group, you know what I mean? You know, I'd be a model if it was about being on the cover of newspapers. The Oasis don't play the game in England and will not suck up to the enemy and be on the cover of that paper every 2 weeks and we've got nothing to say. So they decided they were going to try and break the momentum of the band. And then because we wouldn't play the game, then they slagged us off. But, I mean, I've got no time for that paper anyway. It's a piece of... And I can't say it. Well, I can't say shit, can't I? I'm sorry, but... And that's what it is, you know.
What he said, but it was very derogatory. Do you know the quote I'm talking about?
He hopes I die of AIDS.
Yeah.
I think it was a really bad joke.
I think it was misquoted, actually. I don't know what he meant that.
It doesn't really matter. He just learned his lesson. You don't say things like that because you get...
He makes himself look like...
This makes him look stupid.
Do you regret having made the comments about wishing Damon and his bandmate from Blur got AIDS?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what happened there? You said this thing and then people jumped on you and you just had to rethink what you said, or?
Well, I was doing an interview for a British paper and this woman just kept on and on and on about a quote about the band, and I was a bit drunk, so I mean, you know, I just said what I said and I took it back straight away, but she printed it anyway, so, you know, what's done is done, innit, I suppose. Mm-hmm. I mean.
Have you worked it out with the band, or do you feel like you've already sort of come to terms with what had happened?
I don't speak to them, you know, so I gave an apology through the press, so. But, you know, I mean, there's people in England who'll never forgive you for that, and, you know, so be it, you know, but I mean, no, I don't wish death upon anyone, you know. But, you know, I mean, it's done now, it's done and dusted. The more people keep going on about it, I suppose, the bigger the issue becomes. But, I mean, you know, it's just one of them things. It happened and it's done and that's the end of it, really. I just said what I said and, you know, there you go. I mean, it was a stupid thing to say, but, you know, I've said it now and I've apologised. And to me, that should be the end of it.
Coin comes up here and you're on your asses out this door, all right? Now listen, right, we come and play your f***ing music, right? I'm not having coins going blind for the head. I'm f***ing boots and that. You're all going home, you f***ing say the next pit. One, you're f***ing going home early. And we mean it, man.
Because we're from England and we are hard. We're not soft.
Well, the press had a heyday last fall when you missed the first few dates of the tour.
Yeah.
In reality, the band was close to...
I split it up.
Yeah.
We're never gonna split up.
I'm sorry?
We're never gonna split up. We'll just call it a day, shake each other's hands, go to the pub.
What was the agreement you made back early on? Was there any type of...
That I write all the songs and get all the money and everybody else shuts the f*** up and keeps out of my way. Basically. I'll take its record as it comes. That took 15 days because it took 15 days. If this one takes 10 days, then it'll take 10 days. We don't actually go in there and say we're going to do this as quickly as possible. We went in there, we were booked in for 6 weeks, and it took 2 weeks to do so. We just rattled through it really quick because we know what we're doing when we get in there. We've worked out all the ideas before we go in there, because before we go into the studio, we tend to rehearse live all the new songs, so we'll just play them all live and then bung a load of stuff down on top of it, and that's it, it's finished.
So do you have a good ear? I mean, technically.
Music?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I think so.
Perfect pitch, that kind of thing.
I'll say yeah, you know, be big-headed, but at the end of the day, it's not for me to say. I mean, a lot of people buy the records, so they're factually, then I must have.
Okay, I'll ask Bonehead. Does he have a good ear?
Absolutely, yeah. It's yeah. Two. Yeah. Yeah, of course he has, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's all important, is to just have an ear for... Because a lot of people analyse music about what it means, what's the social content and the political content and the sexual content and all the rest of it, and all that really does not matter at the end of the day. If it sounds good, yeah. Buy it. If it doesn't sound good, then you don't buy it. There's sort of three phases. There's like, I'll write a song on an acoustic guitar and then I'll just be hearing it, sort of me singing it out that way, and it's going... The whole song is... The hole on the acoustic guitar is pointing that way, and my voice is pointing that way.
When changing hands from your brain to the guitar to your bandmates, does it lose anything in the translation, or are they able
it gains a lot more than not lose anything, mm-hmm. because you usually write all the songs on an acoustic guitar,
mm-hmm.
and then when we go into a rehearsal room or wherever it is we are, then it becomes electronic. Mm-hmm. So it gains a lot when Bonehead starts playing on it, because then it becomes like an electric song for a rock band, as opposed to just like a ballad on a guitar or whatever. And then when you put drums on it and all that, and then when Liam starts singing it, of course, then it becomes Oasis, you know?
Yeah.
But before that, it's just like usually me, just...
Uh-huh.
It's an old Gallagher song, and then it becomes an Oasis song when you give it to the chaps.
If people ask me that question a million times, it's like, don't you feel left out? And it's like, why? It's like, because Noel writes the songs, Liam sings them. They got all the press, this, that, and the other, all the attention. It's like, don't you feel left out? It's like, how can I be left out? I'm part of it. I'm part of Oasis, whether I'm rhythm guitarist, singer, bass, doesn't matter. It's still a part of the band, I'm still involved.
Before I leave the studio. I just write words to make them rhyme, basically. I mean, some songs have deeper meanings than others. You know, like this song, for instance, some might say, I mean, don't even ask me what that's about. I don't know what the faintest idea, you know, sink is full of fishes. I know that everyone had dirty dishes on the brain, but, you know, kids get out of it what they get out of it, you know, and it's not for me to say one way or the other what it's about. To me, it's not about anything, it's just about making music that people remember when they when they hear it on the radio and they think, I like that song.
So a lot of people come up to me and they go, Live Forever, is it about this or I think it's about that? And there's all these different interpretations, but at the end of the day, it shows that people are sitting down and they're looking into a song, aren't they? They're actually listening to the words and they're thinking, what's that about? That, to me, shows a classic song, you know what I mean? People sit down and start trying to work out what it's about, rather than just, oh, yeah, there's another song next.
How crap life is anyway, especially for young people at the moment. I don't think you need your favourite pop star telling you how bad his life is, because it only makes you, it only doubles the sadness listening to a record. I think records are entertainment, and they should make you, and they should be uplifting. And you shouldn't have to come home from work or come home from trying to find a job and put on a record and hear some pop star whining about his childhood. You don't need that. I think that you should have pop stars telling you about. That maybe tomorrow it's going to be all right. Records are entertainment, right? And records should make you feel good about yourself, or they should take you away from the surroundings that you're in just for that 3 minutes and maybe put a smile on your face or just give you a buzz.
Do you treat every song when you're working on it as if it's going to be a single?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah,
because every song is, regardless of it being a single or not, every song is an Oasis song, and every Oasis song has got to be special because of the... Of the standards that we... because of the standards that we set ourselves in the past. I mean, our B-sides are better than our A-sides sometimes, so we've got to keep that standard going or it'll look like... You know, it'll look like things are slipping and people will start writing the band off, so... Every song is... We take every song really personally, you know what I mean? And it's, I write every song as though it's the last song I'm ever going to write, so I make sure it's a f***ing good one, you know.
Would you defend Oasis as a collective unit? Because I know some people would say that Noel is Oasis.
On stage, we're a collective unit because we're live performing to a crowd, but in the studio, I mean, I write the songs and I produce the records, so in the studio, then it's not a collective unit, but outside of the studio, yeah, it is. It's a totally collective unit.
Are your best songs still ahead of you?
Absolutely, some of them, yeah. I would say that I'll probably never better Morning Glory, but I'll equal it. But I may never better it.
Playing live.
That hour and a half is the most important thing. The rest of it surrounding the hour and a half, i.e. the travelling on the bus, the promotion.
The interviews.
The interviews and stuff like that. Everything surrounding the gig is neither here nor there. I like meeting the fans and all the rest of it. And, you know, doing autographs and all that, because you've got to do it for them, because they make you what you're out. Doing festivals, especially the English ones, especially Glastonbury, it's like backstage it's really, really childish. It's like you get all these bands who are like, especially on the stage of Iran, which is the NME stage, and there's like 30 bands on a day, and they're all sort of part of the same, I wouldn't say genre of music, but, you know, they're all playing to the same crowd, and all the same crowd will buy, like, various different bands' records. So backstage, there's all this, like, there's all these little camper vans and all that, you know, got about, and there's all this, like, little rivalry thing that goes on there. It's like, they all, like, stand there and ignore each other. Oh, there's Oasis. Red Skellions, Ruffians. All, you know, all these English bands, it's all like this rivalry thing, and it's like, do me a favour, man, you know what I mean? Because they all know, right, that they're crap and we're the best band in England, so it's like, don't ignore us for the facts, you know what I mean? It's not our fault. It's like, pay homage.
Do you like playing for someone else's audience? Last time I saw Oasis was opening for Neil Young.
And yeah, I don't mind it as long as we're great and we sound good.
Is there a sense of converting maybe them?
Maybe, yeah. I don't. Well, they pay us well. That's what I'm doing it for.
There are many things that I would like to say to you, but I don't know how. Said I don't know how. Because maybe. Gonna be the one who saves me. And after all, you're my wonderwall.
Because you've reached this level, you probably get asked to do a lot of benefits.
Don't get asked to do that many. I some of that I don't really like doing because I don't, you know, don't want to sound like a pontificating tosser, do you know what I mean? I just like playing, you know, I just like playing guitar, singing. What, you know, that's it, really.
So would it matter what the benefit is if they'll ask you and you're nearby and
Oh, well, yeah, well, I wouldn't do anything for, like, f***ing, you know. Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, I'm not really interested in like, causes either, really. I mean, you know, I know what's right and I know what's wrong. You know? I don't think singing a few f***ing songs is ever going to change the world, you know. But if it means something to people, then, you know, I'll be there. Just do my shit and leave, you know. If it gets a bit of publicity for someone's also righteous cause, then that's, you know, that's fair enough, I suppose, isn't it?
Would you choose the songs that you would play based on the benefit?
No.
In terms of lyrics? What lyrics would work? No, nothing like that?
No. No, not really. I just go and sing like the singles, the things that people want to hear, really, you know.
That's true.
I'm not going to sing and give peace a chance, you know, and all you need is love or anything like that. You know? Oh, that'd be nice. That's not a bad idea, really, is it?
I know you, you know me. One thing I can tell you is you've got to be free. Come together right now.
Oasis has never hidden their influences. You're first to admit who you really dug growing up and stuff. Is that one of the perks of the job, if you can call it a job, is just be able to connect with these people? I mean, is it a big deal to meet someone that you've listened to for years?
I would have if I wasn't in a band, but you've got to keep a certain amount of professional respect. You can't go running up asking him for his autograph, you know what I mean? Because he probably think you're right, knobhead. As for Paul Weller, well, you know. He's a mate more than anything, Paul, you know. I mean, I was like, when I met him, what was it, Glastonbury? I mean, I've, you know, I'll always be a fan of his music. But, yeah, no, it's nice to work with people who you respect, really, just to see what they're like, just to see if they're as good as they make out, and just to see if you're as good as them.
Paul Weller on the album for one track.
Yeah.
How was it to link up with Paul?
It's all right. He's been a mate for a while, you know. I played on his album, so it just so happened that I was around when he was recording his album, and he was around when we were doing ours. So, I mean, the way it is when friends who are friends and they're in groups, if you're sort of around and, you know. They're like, well, what are you doing tonight? And it's like, we're in the studio, why don't you come down and, you know, see what it sounds like and see how it comes out, which is how I got to be on his album, which is how he got to be on ours, really. It was just like, you know, we were coming to do a guitar solo on Champagne Supernova, and it was like, yeah, do you want to play it? It's like, yeah, all right. Is someone we've known for quite a while, yeah. And he once said he came up to us at Glastonbury Festival and said he'd like to do something with us after Tim Burgess had done something with him, and we did this song that became Setting Sun, and we'd sent him an instrumental and he wrote the lyrics and came and did it. So yeah, he sort of did approach us, yeah, and we just went along with it and did it. It was cool.
It was a really good experience doing it. It was like, it's really exciting. It's very good. He's got a great track out of it as well, you know.
How did the band react to the Chemical Brothers single?
Liam claims not to have heard it yet. This is lying. They probably think it's shit, to be quite honest. Because they've all got their heads up their asses musically. They're all sort of, they like rock and roll and that's it. Which is fair enough, I suppose, but I'm more open to a lot of different things really than them. I don't think they liked it. They never said they did. I didn't ask them anyway, who cares? You know what I mean? It's what to do with them.
I can't see Oasis becoming a techno band. I don't think you'd want to become a techno band.
Not at all, but I think there's elements of that music that could be incorporated into our music. I'm not sure what they are yet, and I might be completely wrong when we start to try and do it. But you know, I don't think you can just dismiss it.
Okay.
Music's just music at the end of the day. Doesn't matter if it's rock and roll, jazz, but well, certain about jazz, which is shit. It doesn't matter if it's, you know, blues or soul or whatever, it's all music. I mean, it's like Jimi Hendrix once said, there's only two forms of music. One's good, and the other one's not good.
Electronica, techno.
Oh, shite, innit? I don't know anything about it, so I can't really comment on it. I've never let that into my world, do you know what I mean? It's just over there, innit, to me.
So, what do you think of the Chemical Brothers?
All right.
And no.
Right. Okay, though, that kid's great. But I don't like him. Nice lads and that, I don't like the music. Okay. I'm rock and roll, man.
What was it like writing with Liam Gallagher?
It was like any other day around his house.
Yeah. He doesn't usually write with Oasis. It's usually Noel who does the writing.
I don't think there's any usually. No. Liam doesn't write. Okay. Noel does everything, yeah.
All right.
But, yeah, it's, the raw talent is there.
Has he offered to write a song or anything, or is he perfectly content with the relationship now?
I would assume he's happy because he's still in the group, so... He's never offered to write a song, though. But then again, neither has anyone else.
Have you ever heard anything he's written or read anything he's written?
I've heard the one that he wrote with John Squire, yeah. Which is pretty good.
Okay.
Top tune. He's been writing the song for about six years on the guitar now. So I'm
Do you have no problem singing someone else's thoughts?
No, I don't care.
Cause I mean, it's obviously it's worked for this.
It's the same thought as me. He's thinking the same thing, and we both lived the same lives.
Okay.
So obviously we're both in the same, you know what I mean? If something happens, you know, we're both walking down that same road, aren't we?
Yeah.
So obviously we're thinking the same. I think if I have, you know, everything he writes and that, I can relate to.
Have you ever been disappointed?
By anyone I've met?
Or wanted to meet and have met?
Yeah, I met some knobheads in my time, yeah.
I'm sorry?
I've met some f***ing idiots in my time, yeah. Like, who's I meet? Phil Collins, I met him, I f***ing hate him.
You hate him before you met him?
Oh,
or both?
Absolutely, yeah. No,
okay.
I hated him sooner before. In fact, before I was born, I hated him.
had said that it's the beginning of a new era for Oasis.
It's probably the end of an era more than the beginning of a new one. I suppose, isn't it? Well, in a way, the end is the beginning, isn't it?
I think we're going to have to move in different directions after this record because we can't. The sound's becoming a bit too obvious now, I think. But by the time we get to make another record, it'll be around 2 years from now, so who knows where we'll be then, but... So it's more like the end of something than the beginning of something else. And we did try things that we'd never done before, but... Like, there's a lot of backwards stuff and drum loops and, you know, stuff like that going on. I suppose in its own little way we were experimenting, but we didn't try anything that drastic. Most important album that we'd probably ever do, because the first album we sort of really weren't a big band then. It was a David album. The second album was was released before anybody sort of knew who we were, type of thing. We only sort of came big after Wonderwall. So, but now everybody's eyes are focused on the release of this album. So we decided not just to rattle it off, if you like. We sort of redone a lot of things and second-guessed a lot of things. It's just approaching it in a different way, because we'd done the other two, sort of just went in and played them live in the studio type things. But this time it's like, made a conscious effort to, try and do it differently.
Rock and roll fans can be fickle,
right?
And a lot of people went out and bought the second one because it's Oasis.
Yeah.
Is there any maybe worry that that sort of mentality won't be there for the third one, or maybe on down the road?
I'm not particularly minded, you know, whether they buy it or not. I don't really f-ing give a shit. Because I love it, I'll buy it. You know what I mean? I just know that we've played on a great album and it's one of the best. It's the best we've ever done. They'll buy it. You can't not buy it. That's what music does to you.
Now, when I first started reading about Oasis, it was a sex, drugs, rock and roll lifestyle, goopy shagging. Marriage changed you guys at all?
Yeah, it's just drugs and rock and roll. I don't think it'll change us as people. I can't see it, really. I don't think you'd want it to, really, would you? I wouldn't. She's still my girlfriend, as far as I'm concerned. I still can't get the word wife out. But yeah, I don't, don't it?
Cease to amaze you how fast and how big it's gotten?
Oh yeah, every day, all the time. I mean, even if, regardless of the 15 million albums and the record-breaking gigs and all this, if somebody would have told me 3 years ago I'd be playing with Neil Young, I'd have laughed, you know what I mean? But here we are, we're going to be playing with Neil Young, as well as selling all that amount of records and being massive all over the world. I mean, it's a dream come true. It's any young boy's dream come true, do you know what I mean? To be doing something that you love. With four of your best friends, getting paid extremely well for it, and playing with people that you respect, it's a great thing, you know what I mean? And we praise the Lord.
haven't you?
Yeah.
That's it. Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks very much.